Dear guests, now it's so important to have some skills and tools to maintain your enthusiasm, especially in this business. Let's bring our next moderator up for our creative design effects on weddings panel. The director of Touchwood Group, please join us on stage, Mr. Vijay Arora. Welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah, hello. Joining Mr. Arora, our esteemed panelists, and we'll continue. Wedding planner for Maya Toubia wedding events and more, Miss Maya Toubia.
Guys, can you be a little louder? Sorry, my mic is loud. Can we all sit? Can we all please sit? Have one meeting in time. Mr. Jan, can you come in the front? Why are you at the back? Please come in the front.
Yeah, Miss Maya Toubia, and we are continuing managing partner of Vivaah Weddings, Mr. Rahul Kumar.
Come.
Neelabh. Oh my God, he needs a song for his entry. Can we play a song for Neelabh's entry, please? Who's there at the sound console? Anand, are you handling the sound console?
Hello.
Can you play a song for the Neelabh entry?
For the rock star. Here, Vijay Arora.
Neelabh is a rock star, guys.
Hi, man.
Okay. Yes. Guys, I think we all had good food, right?
Yes.
We all have good food, huh? We're all ready for the party in the evening. We'll just spend half an hour and we'll party. We'll not do any session, right? So please be normal, chill more. Can we request, JD bhai, please come in the front, Nayar. Why you at the back? Please come. Everybody, can we request? Karan, please come in the front. All people who are standing there, can they please come and take their seats? Wow. Kaun aayega stage pe? Somebody want to come onto the stage? Acha, Kale? He resembles me a lot, he can come. good afternoon, everyone. Somebody was playing us music. Song, I heard, oh no. Achha, she's cut it down, man. Sorry. Maya, hi, good afternoon.
Hi.
How are you feeling?
I'm good.
Great. Can we have Maya's mic?
Hello.
Hello. So
should I sing?
Yeah, you can sing, Maya. Till the time you can sing. You can tell me something about yourself, how.
I think it's working, yeah.
Yeah, great, go ahead.
Thank you.
Sure. Hi, good afternoon.
Hi.
So Maya is here from Lebanon, that's
yes.
Right, and she's a celebrated wedding designer. Lebanon, as far as I know, it's rich in culture. Weddings is a celebration there, like a festival in India. That's right, Maya.
Yes.
So what, in your way, what do you think that, what makes an experience unique in the weddings? And how do you define a unique experience?
So creating unique weddings is not only creating a nice decoration and design and concept. In my opinion, it's more like creating an experience to the couple and especially to the guests. So you want them, from the time they step into the wedding until they leave, to experience something different and not only attend another wedding. So we want to integrate them inside the wedding. It's like, you
Maya,
know, when you
we all are senior wedding planners there, and they know what, how to create it. I'm saying, in your sense, in Lebanon, how do you create a unique experience?
Yeah, this is what I'm saying.
Okay.
It's just when they step into, it's not just watching and seeing nice designs, nice centerpieces. It's the experience, it's the feelings they will have during that wedding. You know, it's like when you watch movies, you go to the theater, and if you like the movie, you go into the movie, you feel you're there, and then you forget that you're in a movie theater. So this is what I mean. And by unique, it could be choosing a special venue by itself. It could be unique. Instead of using, let's say, the usual wedding ballrooms and hotels, or instead of renting villas, you can like just have your wedding in an old silk factory, or an old left train station, or a cultural space. So the venue by itself could be really, it helps you like create
so,
this.
So designer need to be creative to choose the right venue. That's what you mean to say?
Yes, it's okay. One of the ways, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Great. Any experience which you would like to share with us? Any unique experience you have used in a wedding so far, or a venue which you have turned into a different thing altogether?
Yeah, like every wedding is unique. You can either, like once we transformed a ballroom because it was a winter wedding and they wanted an outdoor wedding. So you transformed all the ballroom, the people who already attended weddings in this ballroom, they would never expect this space to be the same space, you know, they stepped in. Or for example, so this, you create the outdoor, indoor, or vice versa. We once built, you can use oversized elements, like we built a huge cake where we seated the guest on that cake and created an internal wow. elevator that led the couple to the top of the cake, and they looked, they had their first dance there, and they looked like cake toppers. So this
wow.
is really
this
like
is
creating an experience, a different experience. But this doesn't have to be, sometimes small things, memorable things could be also.
My good, that's very interesting to know.
Yeah.
Thank you, I will come back to you. Rahul, hi.
Hi.
Rahul, we all know, is from Dubai, which is better India, we can say in that way.
Yes, true.
So you, I think you've been in business for long. So Rahul, the question for you is that people are interested in sharing their own stories and experience through social media days. So what is your observation about it? How do you perceive it in terms of, are you, do you see that it's fine to share, or it's different in a way? What is your observation on a social media sharing of the overall experience which you create?
Sure, I think it's an evolution in our industry.
Mm-hmm.
It's like an extended marketing team or an extended sales force that's out there promoting your best works. Back in the day, there used to be a time where people used to identify which journal, which magazine, or which newspaper they need to advertise in, and which would cost a lot of money. Here you've got an extended team talking about your works, and especially it makes a lot more effective purpose if a third person is endorsing your work. So I could bang drums about and blow trumpets about my company and my creations, but if my bride and her friends and the guests in that wedding are talking about it and promoting it, it brings a lot more mileage. So I think it's a very strong medium of advertising and marketing.
Right, great. We'll come to Neelabh. Neelabh, good afternoon. We all know Neelabh, right? He's the most celebrated designer in India, and at EMEX, which we know is the biggest event industry awards. He won about 4 awards this year. And Neelabh, so for you, the question is, now weddings are getting larger. Everything is getting larger than life. It's not used to a ballrooms or creating just a backdrop or something like that. How does you, basically your ideation come into the picture when it comes a larger than life weddings? You have done a fantastic big wedding in Dubai. And what is your take on the budget? So is budget is restricts you when you think something big, or what's your take on the creative and the budget aspect both?
I think first most important thing is to sell a dream. When you sell a dream, can everybody hear me?
No. Can we have his mic a little louder, please?
Now, hello? No. Can
anyone? No, I don't think the mic is working.
Can anyone put my mic on, please?
They can. No, no, they can listen to you like this.
Okay. Now.
Can you give him a handheld if you have a different microphone?
Can you get them a microphone?
Yeah, yeah, they're getting a microphone. Can you give them a cordless, please, if possible? Thank you.
The mic number is 2. 2.
Then that's Rajiv's room number.
Hello. Hi.
Yeah.
Hi, everyone. Yeah. Now, I really want to make this session very interesting, because last time when I was on stage, I was start sleeping myself. So I think it's very important for us to all have fun and have a very interactive session. And that's what I feel at, rather having very specific questions which are boring to audience. Audience should be more involved in, you know, asking. So if I'm answering and anybody has a question right away, it will be more interesting and fun. So experiences are created with a lot of money. Wherever there is money, the experience can be created. Because everybody thinks that, you know, you can create ideas and you can execute it in little money, but that those days are gone. I think everybody is so well-traveled and everybody has seen the world. You need to create something which is always extraordinary. And extraordinary only comes with the experience of creating something which is unusual. And that's what I feel by trying to get something which is very agronomic, which is custom-made, tailor-made, by making the client understand. It's not only about the physical feel to the design, it's also about, for example, recently we did a project in outskirts of Dubai, which was like a barren land. It was an arena of 36,000 square meter, and we had to create an experience there. It was complete like a Rio amphitheater, like a complete desert area. The idea was to accommodate 1,200 guests and sell them in a concept which actually could accommodate 20,000 people. So we had created Michelin star restaurants all across, and there was a distance of 500 meters between the one side and the other side. But whatever was available on the one side was duplicated on the other side, and we had 8 specific restaurants on either side. Creating an experience for a Babel Sham arena by giving a luxury feel by having a Michelin star restaurant like Heba, like Adira, Masala, by giving them a sit-down dinner experience while a walk-in restaurant, is about experiences. By designing, it doesn't mean only physical or by bridal entry or creating big large sets or putting up chandeliers and drapes. It's about the entire experience. I think by creating, giving them an experience from A to Z, and you excite them by selling a dream that in a barren land, you're growing trees. You're creating something which is they've never seen and experienced when they drive down from the town and come all the way by 90 minutes and then suddenly see an arena which is completely lit up. And then you find the best of the food from the globe and you pay like huge amount of money, which is in dirhams. So that's where the numbers come on. And that's what excites. So like somebody spending 2,000 dirham per person in an arena like that, plus licenses, plus transportation, plus 3 other catering companies, agencies doing the entire part, that excites me. So with money, you can do wonders. If you don't have money, then no experience.
So that is the question, Neelabh, that how you excite people to get out the money?
You present them ideas, you sell them a dream. I started with a dream. So you present a concept, a design, that why do you do a project which is away from a city which is 90 minutes to drive, when you have all the amenities and the infrastructure right in the middle of town, you can get the same star quality, food, experience, design, decor, entertainment. You need to create budgets to take them to a barren land and create wonders out of India.
Yeah. So that's because you want your billing to go high?
Of course.
Yeah.
You're only working here to create something extraordinary, and money is not there, then there's no excitement.
Great. But my question to again you is that how you get these kind of clients who are ready to spend this kind of money?
I don't know, seriously. Even I don't get so often. Sometime I get lucky.
Great. So we'll come back to Maya. Maya, you work in Dubai, you work in Lebanon or different countries. How are you able to manage these standards in terms of, and what is the main barrier when you go to, let's say you go to Dubai or any other country, how you manage these standards to be same as in your country?
Well, as a wedding planner, your main assets, of course, is your team and the suppliers you're working with, whether it's in your country or in different countries. So the most important thing to keep the standard when you go to other countries to destination for destination weddings is, first of all, to have your team with you, or at least the key persons. And second and most importantly, to know how to select the suppliers, because suppliers are everything. The vendors, you're nothing without your suppliers. So you're just the chef d'orchestre, you know. So it's very important important to know how to choose them. And you know, these events are really helping us a lot because we get to meet amazing people from the industry, whether it's from the hotel side or from the suppliers. And even like we're building very good relationships with wedding planners from around the world. Like I can see the faces I see everywhere. If I get a wedding in Italy, I know that I have a backup, or in India, or anywhere in the world, I know that I have a backup because of these great inventions and the fam trips. And of course, you have to think ahead about the challenges in terms of infrastructure, in terms of transportation, in terms of maybe he mentioned the license. There are in several countries, like in Dubai, if you want to get entertainment or a dancer, you have to pay a certain license for this dancer. So you have to know the rules and regulations inside each country.
What is the one point which we always keep in mind, which you travel to a different country? What is the key?
For us, it's you know, it's the flights, because we want direct, like Lebanese, they don't like to.
I'm talking about the production part. How you get your production right in place. What is the one key point which you keep in mind when you go to a partner or a vendor or to a country or any DMC for that matter? What is one or two major points which we need
everything.
To keep in
mind? Everything. You have to know what to ship with you and what to take from the country you're working on. Let's say the flowers or the fabrics or the printout. Or, you know, there are things you can ship everything, but it will cost maybe more if you ship them. So it really depends on each item.
Okay, great. I was trying to do a wedding in Turkey. I think the biggest barrier is the language. So what I feel is when you come to Turkey, you should have an interpreter with you. Even to get a sound, we were trying to get a song played, but it took us 10 minutes to tell him, boss, we want to get the sound played. So I think that's the most key point which everybody keep in mind when they go to any country, have an interpreter from the day you enroll him for the entire journey, from day one to the, because language is a very, very big barrier to get your things rolling. Thank you. We'll come to Rahul. Rahul, event management, I think, considered to be the fifth most, stressful job in. Yes. You want to say something? Karan wants to say something. No. No, it's not the first. It's the fifth. Yes, it's fifth in the top 10. So how do we all manage our stress? And do you have any specific practices before or after your events? Just for an idea that what do you do or how you actually go through this journey that we don't get into the stress.
Sure. I think, do you have a mic here? I'll get this, thanks. I think there's two levels of stress that we're talking about. There's internal stresses and there's external factors that also stress you out. Internal being, if you don't have the right team, that can be stressful. To negate that, to counter that, what we ourselves do is we mainly consider that our team's longevity and the legacy of the people who work with us have had certain experience behind them. So the people that work for us have been with us for the longest of times. But the other stress that we're talking about, which is external factors, what we do is we work with a timeline sheet which we send out to all our vendors and our clients right from the beginning when the wedding is signed up, which also tells them about when each aspect of the wedding can be attended to and be completed. So it does not come to a situation where the bride or the family or our vendors are stressed about when this particular item will be looked into. It's a roadmap that is given out to the families and the vendors, and we work on the basis of that. So to a large extent, we can manage our stress that way. However, situations do arise on the day as well. In a situation that arises on the day of the event, the key is not to look stressed yourself.
Yes.
Keep calm, because when you're calm and you go up to the client or your vendor, I think a lot is taken care of right there. Solutions can be sprung up much easily than in a panic mode.
Great. So how many of us in the room use timeline sheets? Do we all use timelines? All of us? We genuinely use it, or should we request Rahul to share it with us? If we need, we can request him. I think he's a good guy. He can share it with us. Rahul, you can share the timeline?
Yeah, I'm sure everyone else is doing
that
better than
I think it will be his vision or his way of looking. The timeline sheet could be different from us. So if anybody is interested, you can contact him offline after this and he'll be happy to share it, right?
Sure, yeah.
Neelabh, everybody, when Neelabh Kapoor names come, it's come. First thing which comes into my mind is the lion, because his logo is loud, clear like he. What is your inspiration? What do you think? You from where you get inspired, and you think that you avoid a social media to get inspired, because most of people here get inspired from social media, from Instagram or Pinterest or Google. How do you different from others? Being original, because today I see, I think 90% of wedding planners or designers are inspired wedding planners or designers. How are you different from this normal?
I think everybody is very creative by themselves. Vijay, when I see your work, the way you have, from the time when you started off, you had a limitation in your mind, then you broke that limitation, you wanted to then get on to the next level and you started designing something bigger and larger. And I remember those days that you said, I can't think beyond this, my team cannot think beyond this point. So I think it's very natural that everybody has the strength, but they don't want to utilize it. Like, I'm very bad with numbers, so and I get bored and I don't understand the Excel never in my life. I can never sit on a timeline sheet and I can never put together a number sheet. So for me, it's not like that. So for me, I think it's all about, Pinterest is not my best friend. So I hate that kind of a feel that if everybody's doing what they have to do, then what is the need and requirement for to be what I have to be? So I probably try to get inspired by people. I extract energies. When I'm sitting with people, I extract energies and I pull out energies and I think and travel. When I'm sitting in my car, I watch so many things when I'm driving and I put things together. So when I had a mentor, when I started my career, Martin from 70, he told me that you are very smart, you know, you don't work, you just pick up things from here and there and put them together. That's what I've been always like a child, because I started like doing sculptures. So I used to just pick up, stuff from here and there and then put them together and make it like a fusion. So my design language is always about adaptability, and I'm not original, but I try and do a fusion, which is a culmination of a lot of things together, and then I create something which is unusual. That becomes, to me, it becomes original, but somewhere down the line, it's inspired. And everybody here, we all looking for inspiration, and everybody has to find a way to get inspired. And everybody has a talent.
Now. Yes. Great. So what do you get your designs registered under the IP or whatever?
No, unfortunately, I don't think that's there, because whether it's fashion or whether it is art industry, patent and IP is a big threat. But I think it's a compliment, because I see when I probably must have done a design 10 years back, 11 years back for a Vidhi Mandap, that the entire chapel is still being redesigned in the same fashion and been, I can see everywhere. But it's there. You can't do anything about it, because little tweak here and there, you can find a way out.
Yeah.
So IP is something which we all need to work for it, but everybody is finding way to copy and, you know, replicate, and that's how it is. The industry survives.
So we can't do anything about it. So we all have to just let it go.
No, I think we have to keep evolving, and every time, every season, every time you need to come up with something new and different. And it becomes very easy for people to just, because Lebanon is the most highly creative part of the world, which I see a lot of designs coming from Lebanon. And Lebanese are the guys who actually are very strong with their sensibilities and the management and hospitality. And we see kind of designs and presentations, all inspiration, mood boards coming out of that part of the region. And so that's a compliment to, you know, and we all look into it, but there is somewhere that we need to find a way that we start creating stuff in India, I'm talking about, by creating some designs which can be patented, but it's all about product specification. So you can patent a television, you can patent a product which has a specific, like a chair or a model or a car, but those are a different level. In our industry, patent is not possible. I don't think so.
So basically anybody copies your design, you need to be chill, relax. You can't do anything
no,
about
it. No, we can't chill. It's bad, but then people
yeah,
do that.
People do, yeah. But we can't do legally anything about it. That's what you
legally,
want.
Legally, yeah, you can go on Facebook and you can start, put a complaint and you can start fighting and you can have nasty things coming back your home. But it's okay, fine.
I think Aarti does a lot on that, so. So that's fine.
Aarti is a woman with steel balls. She can do anything.
Great. We'll come to Maya. Maya, technology is taking a lot of space in our entire decor or a designing aspect. What do you think about it? And do you think that in a budget limits, can we use technology better than the conventional way to make things look better?
Yeah, technology helps a lot, especially when you have a big budget, because as he mentioned before, if you don't have the budget, that doesn't mean you can't be creative. Some small weddings are super creative, but technology it definitely helps us a lot with all the media, the 3D mapping, the lighting, the screens, the LED technologies. But again, being creative is different than it's not the different, like if you're creative, you can do anything with any budget as long as you know where to spend your budget. So for technology, if you ask me for the budget, if it like affects the budget, yes. Like if.
But do you think technology is taking a major role?
Yes, yes, definitely.
So what?
Definitely. Like if you go back 5 years ago, there was, or even more, there was 3D mapping and it was new, but now everyone is using it. And then the things that are coming in the future are even like more huge. And yes, you can integrate them in the weddings. And the weddings are the latest trends. And as he said, if you check the Lebanese weddings
So my question is, using technology is cheaper or
No.
No way.
Yeah.
But India, it's considered to be because we get LED at rupees 100 square
feet. But in Lebanon, no, technology is expensive.
Okay.
Yeah.
Great. We'll come to Rahul. Rahul, for everybody, I think all people sitting here are artists. Every wedding planner think that he's the most creative guy in the world. And I also think so. So what means to you as an art? For her, definition of art is different. For Neelabh is different. For me is different. For this, how do you define art in your way? What is art for you?
So as you rightly said, I think the answer lies in the first part of your question itself, whereas art means different to everybody else. What could be art for me today could be
subjective.
It could be uninspiring and rubbish for Neelabh, possibly. And it could be the other way too. But art means
different things to different people. I think the point here is, as Neelabh said earlier, and I would second what he said, is the world around us is a constant source of inspiration that contributes towards art. So things that you see, things that you experience yourself can always be used towards art. Art can be not just in pieces, but also the entire experience. So the key being observe, look around, gauge what you can, absorb what you can, and if you like it, don't try and impose and sell your idea to the client. Understand how they feel about it. If not, let them do much of the talking, be a good listener, because what may have inspired her, this as a bride, or what may have inspired the family is something that you may have missed. Sometimes they come up with the smallest of details, the remotest of information that can blow up to be a huge experience and theme in itself.
Great. Coming to you, Neelabh, everybody knows what you do. So can you share us a great experience of yours, means in terms of the experience, as what is the great experience in your view you have created so far, and what was the challenge or how you actually executed it?
I think the biggest thing which I've been able to succeed is to survive. So
wow.
Survival is very
He's important. Been so generous, man.
I've been in this industry from last 14 years, when I traveled from a small town called Dehradun, a small village in India, and came to a metro. So it's been a survival till now. And I look into budding stars like Anand, who's done a fabulous job in Antalya, and bringing Antalya on a world map. So we see ourselves now, seeing the new generation coming up with brilliant ideas. And I think everybody is very creative in this house. And when I see Meghna's, how she creates videos and films, and she showcases, that's what brings life to our decor. So everybody in this house, like Rajiv, has the mind of finance and numbers, and he's master with collaborations and acquiring companies and investing. And I think that's what we're all learning, you know, with his, the finesse of Chetan, his the dedication he has when he actually works so dedicatedly on his weddings, and you know how we all love him as the best viz of our viz craft, ex-viz, vizy. So I think that gives a lot
industry
of,
ruled by ex-vizes, yeah. Huh? Okay, that's fine. Yeah, you're also ex-viz, huh?
I'm also ex-viz. Yeah, the shortest time. Yeah.
No, so any experience which you would like to share with us, the good, bad, or the best, whatever.
I don't know. I think the best experience is yet to come, because I still feel that there's nothing which I've done till now much. So I would probably wait and not excite myself to be that I've done and achieve something experience. But I think the last experience of 9 months, 10 months of dedicated time spent out of India and spending time in Dubai, establishing us little self in to be in a UAE, where which we are little well. Now, no people know us, and we kind of now we did the royal family project, and now we're a little bit into the business of UAE. I think that's overall experience was as a survival in a new country by setting up a base and being away from everything was something which was an experience or a unique thing. Because event, life is an event. We all survive because we do business and we are the business of doing events. But we forget that life every day by itself is an event. So my journey in UAE in last 10 months has been a larger than life event for myself. I think that's what I will probably say is one of the biggest achievement, what I feel by.
May I ask you why you shifted from India to Dubai?
I'm not just because I've just started. Okay. I've just started expanding.
It's just because of the number 1:20 or is
yeah,
there any?
I'm excited to work with the great minds, and I think India has the best talent, but I also feel that, you know, little
Dubai has a better talent.
Try to see ourselves into another land and just evaluate ourselves. But I'm doing little work in India as well. I'm not doing.
But you're doing most of your work in Dubai nowadays.
Little bit.
Just because of the numbers, or just one line.
I think you
want to earn more, or it's the creative satisfaction.
I love the experience which I get when I work with people in Dubai. Like example, that I had the best lighting discussion meeting with my lighting company when I was designing the event at the outskirts of Dubai in Bab el Sham. The entire 40-45 people conference room was booked, and the entire presentation was done to brief them on a projector, and everybody from the department, HODs to their coordinates to everybody, like everybody taking down minutes, everybody was so involved, and it was looking like as if it's their event, not mine.
Wow.
The kind of people I'm meeting and interacting internationally is giving me more happiness, that because I always believe in one thing, that if I bring my stresses of life down, I always have to work with smarter people and better people than what I am.
Yeah.
So the feeling of working with good people is really giving me happiness. Not that India doesn't have smarter and good people. India has brilliant, as I mentioned. But the professionalism and the approach and the way they handle and they understand is little different.
India is good in allocation of job.
Yeah,
so rather than
it's different, you know. Ho jayega, kar lenge, last minute. You know, they are different. I think they start working for you more than you work on the event. So that gives you more happiness, and you get more time to start thinking and work more towards servicing the client.
Great. So guys, I don't know how many of you know that Neelabh is a freelancer designer. So any wedding planner want to invite him or hire him for his clients, his can you disclose them your fee so that they can at least thinking of pitching you to their clients? And well, it's a good marketing which I'm doing for
yes,
you.
Yes, so
you
can. Yes, of course, always available without any issues. If you get along well and you can tolerate me, so yeah.
How fees?
Fees is very subjective, yeah, subjective.
I know it's subjective. It starts from where, so that at least people
but
sitting in a room.
Will tell you.
Yeah, you want to tell your fee?
No, nobody will tell.
No. Why? He's a very open guy. He doesn't mind him. Okay. Don't worry. I know you will not tell, but he'll not mind.
No, it's very standard fees in India. And in fact, Sumant is here.
Why are you targeting him? We're asking about your fee. Sumant is, we know how much he charges.
We have a very standard category of management fees, which everybody knows, and design fees.
How much?
It starts from anywhere and goes to anywhere.
See?
What is anywhere? That's what we want to know.
No, oh my God.
$5,000?
To the industry people's special discount.
$5,000? Just for one visit he charges otherwise.
Yeah, I know you gave me once. Yes, I appreciate that.
No, no. Great, guys. Anybody has any questions or should we just wrap up the... Anybody have any questions?
Come on, Arti. Open. Come on, you should have some questions.
Anushree? You're looking so zapped.
Very good.
This is not a. So, Nila, one more question for you. Do you think creativity can be learned, or do you think creativity can be learned, or improved, or you think creative people are just born like you?
You know, there is creativity in every field. Like how Gaurav would probably cook. It's a creative by himself. Numbers with Rajiv is creative by himself. I sketch, I design. So for me, creativity is in the form of representation in visual. Everybody, when you're planning as a manager, like if you're working as an event manager, that itself is an art. So creativity can be learned in skill sets, which basically, like, if you could start doing sketches now and you start want to do sketches and design 3D, you can pick it up, but then you're ruining your time because you should work on something which you're best at what you're doing. So if, and but creativity is everything. Like even a doctor is a very, surgeon is a, he's very talented.
Most creative.
By himself.
Yeah.
So creativity is in every field. So yes, by design and creativity, it's inborn, they say, but I don't think I'm creative. So it's like...
You've been modest.
It's not inborn. They say that I'm creative, I'm mad, I can design, but it just comes naturally. But I think I love the other side better, you know. Like it's good to learn all
Great.
The aspects.
Maya, same question for you.
Yeah, I think in terms as a wedding planner, like the artistic side, he's correct. Like with different industries, everyone is creative. But if I want to talk about our industry and the art, yes, I do believe that you are born creative. It's in your genes and your DNA. And because creative people, they have this energy and ongoing motivation to create easily and to combine things when you see, when you get inspired, not by Instagram, you mentioned by Instagram. I think people who are not, like you have to know what's happening in the world, but not be inspired by pictures. You get inspired maybe by other industries, by the furniture, by the interior design, even by food. You know, when the marble started a few years ago, it was integrated in the weddings. And 10 years ago, when it was modern, the furniture, it was integrated in the weddings.
Yep.
Same for the, you know. And I know it because we teach in Dubai wedding planning and event management, and the class for creativity is divided practical and theory. And in the practical side, students are given, there's a workshop for table styling and setting. So students are given the same material in terms of fabric, centerpieces, flowers, accessories, and they're asked to create their table before we give them any, we start with the workshop. And you can tell directly who is creative and who is not. And creativity, yes, I believe it can be learned to a certain extent, because the people who are not creative, they will always have difficulties to create by themselves. Creative people, they are, you know, pioneer in creativity. They are trendsetter. They create. This is the difference.
Great. You want to say something? Rahul, you want to add on something to it?
Yeah, I think I agree with them. Of course, we teach students in Dubai. But the fact of the matter is, I think there's an awakening required. Some people have the power and the skill of acquiring creativity and becoming geniuses at an early stage. Some require much more honing and development. So it comes down to how a person grasps these skills. People can be taught. I know of people who have only struck creativity at the age of 50 and have done wonders after that. So they've been working in a very boring job, only known to be programmed, follow directions. but then someday they wake up and
I think they already had it, but they discovered it later.
Possibly.
But it's born, it's in them.
Possibly.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
I think everybody is creative in own way. Like, just say, Rajiv is finance creative. Maybe JD is management creative, super talented. So everybody is creative. You need to find yourself that what part excites you more and what is your specialty, and then you have to work on that. From here on, I think we'll just end this session. If anybody has any questions, we can take it up. Otherwise, we'll just go into the next session.
Thanks.
Thank you very much, everyone. Thanks for being patient and listening to
Thank you.
The